Tonight on Missing Persons Unit...
We've received some information through Crime Stoppers.
..a breakthrough in the 13-year search for Bill Roach.
This is the reference sample that we obtained from the biological mum of the missing person, so if you can compare it to what we've got there.
Only DNA tests will confirm if the lead is genuine.
Just calling you about the William Roach case and the mitochondrial DNA testing.
..and the intriguing case of the missing Danish engineer.
Police are appealing for information to help find a missing 49-year-old Danish tourist.
He checked onto a flight for Denmark but vanished before he even boarded the plane.
Was last seen in the departure lounge, on the lounge.
And the search begins in outback Queensland.
All right, just start moving forward slowly.
Paul Laba is as tough as nails, but has he got what it takes to survive out here?
He's actually walked out. We found footprints.
And whatever happened to 13-year-old Lisa Peters?
Call young people. Stubborn, very stubborn.
Her uncle and aunt still can't believe she's disappeared.
Yeah, I just wanted to come home. And where she belongs.
Good morning, everyone. It is a busy day today.
If today's muster's any indication, it's going to be flat out this week for officers of the Missing Persons Unit.
This morning we've got 30 cases outstanding.
And young teenagers are top of the missing list.
Leah, you have a 13-year-old female reported to Lismore Police.
Constable Leah Wilson gets the case of missing schoolgirl Lisa Peters. Her mum moved to Darwin, but Lisa didn't want to leave her mates in Lismore, so she moved in with her aunt and uncle. A day later, the 13-year-old vanished.
No one has seen her since, and her aunt and uncle are really worried about her.
Thank you. Mandy, you got a 50-year-old Danish national. He's booked on a flight to return home, but he didn't make the flight.
Mandy Gale gets the case of a ship's engineer who came to Australia to work, but he arrived drunk, and his boss ordered him to fly straight back home to Denmark. But Helgi never caught his flight, and no one has seen him since.
I'll do some checks with immigration then, I guess, and maybe he's got a later flight. It's a bit of a worry though, isn't it? No one's seen him.
And for Sergeant Mark Samways, there's finally a breakthrough in his long-term search for Bill Roach, missing for 13 years.
How'd you go the other day in Melbourne?
Since the case of Bill Roach was featured in the first series of the TV show, we've received some information through Crime Stoppers.
But before Mark begins his new search, blood samples taken from Bill's farmhouse months ago must first be matched against his mum's DNA.
If it indicates that it is Bill Roach's blood, there's a good possibility that he has met with foul play.
But if it's not his blood, it'll add weight to the new reports that Bill was spotted alive just days ago.
We'll do our best and we won't give up until we resolve it one way or the other.
In the ongoing case of missing 76-year-old Paul Laba, case officers Jim Ryan and Tony McDowell are still in outback Queensland to help search for the opal miner.
His car's broken down about 20 k's from the road and he's actually walked out. We found footprints. The property owner found footprints at the time to show that...
Paul Laba disappeared from his desert camp a year ago, but police still hope this experienced bushman may be living off the land.
We know he's a fairly tough old bugger, so if anyone can survive out there in the bush, Paul can.
Back in Sydney, in the case of missing schoolgirl Lisa Peters...
I have been liaising with Lismore Police and I just...
Constable Leah Wilson is calling Lisa's uncle Andrew, who saw his runaway niece outside a house in Lismore only 3 days ago.
Oh, OK, so you never saw her walk into the house?
No, they gypped as they walked up the veranda like they were staying there, but they weren't.
Oh, OK. And how did she seem to you when you spoke to her?
She was pretty quiet, but she was talking to us.
Because she didn't want to move to Darwin with her family, Lisa's parents agreed she could stay with her uncle. But after just one day, she took off.
Is there anything that may have happened? Were her relations with her family quite good or...?
Yeah, everything's good. I think the main thing is she likes taking off and hanging with her little friend and just getting into trouble, stealing stuff, taking drugs and everything like that.
Okay.
That's the main reason why she keeps running off.
Lisa's only 13. Runaway and already mixing in the drug scene.
Bye-bye.
We're obviously concerned about her for this because of the sake of her age, so we intend to fly up to Lismore. I'm going to liaise with Lismore Police. I'm going to go and see Lisa's auntie tonight, get some more details and take it from there. It's going to be a matter of knocking on some doors and trying to locate who her friends are.
On the other side of the office, Mark Samways is busy investigating a fresh lead in the case of missing Armidale man Bill Roach.
This is one of the most intriguing cases I've ever worked on. Just when you think you're going down one path, there's a twist and a turn. And to be honest, at the moment, I really don't have a feeling what's happened to Bill Roach.
In the last series, we covered the case of Bill Roach, who disappeared from country New South Wales in 1993.
It's 11, 12 years now, and it's just never gets any easier, let me tell you.
Bill's mum, Yvonne, believed he could still be alive until police delivered heartbreaking news.
We believe now, as a result of our investigations, that he's died as a result of foul play.
One last search of Bill's farm by police revealed bloodstains in his house. This was their best chance to work out what happened to him until Mark Samways received more bad news.
We realised that Billy Roach is actually an adopted son of Yvonne.
So before he could test the blood found at Bill's farm, Mark first had to find Bill's biological mum.
Hello, Margaret. Sergeant Mark Samways from the Police Missing Persons Unit. How are you?
Margaret Weeks, Bill's birth mum, had no idea why she'd been called to police headquarters.
You had a child in 1968?
Yes,
gave birth to a male child?
Yes.
That young man was reported missing as a missing person. No, you're right. I have as much time as you need, OK?
Margaret agreed to provide a DNA sample. But she also asked to meet Bill's adoptive mum.
Yvonne, thank you.
Bill's two loving mums vowed to keep searching for him.
We'll do the rest of this together between the two families.
Okay,
we'll follow it through.
Definitely.
Now police will use DNA to bring an end to 13 years of searching and perhaps closure for Bill's two mums.
I'm taking Dan's down to Melbourne, to the Victorian Institute of Forensic Medicine, where they'll test those samples and hopefully see if it's Bill's blood contained on those samples.
Thank you.
Back in the case of missing schoolgirl Lisa Peters, Leah has arrived in Lismore in northern New South Wales to continue her investigation.
I'm very worried about Lisa. She is only 13, and right now I don't know where she spends her time at night. I believe she has no source of income. I don't know where she's taking shelter. I don't know what she's eating. I don't know if she has any money. And I'm quite concerned about the people that she might be associating with, given her age.
Before she ran off, Lisa was living with her uncle Andrew and his partner, Alison.
It was just the friend she didn't want to leave.
Yeah.
She just kept on taking off and wanting to be with her friends up in Ganilabar and her boyfriend.
She come home with us, we cooked her a meal and everything. She had dinner and by later that night she ran off with her sister. And then we called the police and they called her 2 days later, bring her back and it just kept occurring. She kept running off every time they drop her off.
Now, you've spoken with her mum?
Yeah.
Yep.
She rings every night worrying about her.
Mm. And how's she feeling at the moment?
She's very worried. She doesn't know what to do. Because the kid's that stubborn, she just won't stay anywhere.
Is the idea or the hope that if we locate Lisa, that she then go to Darwin and be with her mum and her dad?
If that's possible,
Is that what the...
They haven't got a house of their own at the moment.
They're trying to get a house.
Yeah, they've only just moved up there and they're trying to get their own place in that first.
It's a worrying time, especially for Alison, who knows what it's like to live on the streets.
I took off when I was 16 and didn't go back home and stuff, so sort of know where she's kind of at. Yeah, kind of. So didn't have anyone, like...
Right, sweet. Don't get upset.
Didn't have many people to help me, sort of thing. So I was kind of just wanting to help her a bit, give her a bit of guidance and stuff.
She's trying to do the right thing by her, sweet.
Yeah.
She just doesn't want our help. Doesn't want anyone's help by the seams of it.
Stubborn.
Yeah.
Like all young people. Stubborn, very stubborn.
Mark Samways has arrived in Melbourne, carrying the bag that contains crucial blood samples that may confirm if Bill Roach is dead or alive.
It's been a very long wait for Bill's two mums, Yvonne and Margaret, and I'm as keen as anyone to get some results to them.
If it is Bill's blood, it'll bring an end to the case and closure for Bill's grieving family.
Hello, Mark. Hi, Mark. April. You too.
So what we've got here is it's a sectional flaw. It's tested positive to having blood on it, and we need that blood profiled if possible.
Mm-hmm.
This is the reference sample that we obtained from the biological mum of the missing person. So if you can compare it to what we've got there.
Yes, yes, okay.
April Smith will now match the samples taken from Bill's farmhouse with the DNA swab provided by his mum.
There's three possible outcomes. One, that the analysis will identify the blood samples as that of William Roach. The other thing it may do is exclude William Roach. Third outcome is that the samples won't be able to be analysed because of degradation and other reasons, and that's really the worst outcome for us, and we don't want to see that happen.
But there's no guarantee the test will be conclusive. If the samples are not Bill's blood, it means it may have actually been him who was seen walking down a street in Brisbane just days ago. Back in Lismore, local police have just acted on a tip-off that's led them to repeat runaway Lisa Peters. It's a surprise to everyone.
She's just been found. We're just going to bring her in.
Oh, fantastic.
So, you want to come round?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thanks.
Lisa might have been found, but for Leah, there's still a long way to go.
I'm Leah from the Missing Persons Unit. How are you going?
Good. I'm
Nigel. I'm Sydney. Hello, Lisa. How are you going? I'm Leah from the Missing Persons Unit in Sydney. We've been worried about you. Huh? A bit quiet. Can you tell me what's happened this morning?
Mate, got a job off the good sergeant to go out and find Lisa, and went to an address in Ganellabar and found it.
Okay, then. Is that an address that's known to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Are you happy to have a chat with me, Lisa? Hmm? Don't be scared, sweetheart. You're not in any trouble, okay? You're not in any trouble at all. Do you want to tell me what's been going on? No? What's upset you, sweetheart? Is there anyone that you want to talk to? Is there anyone we could call for you? No?
It's one of those really difficult moments.
Have you been staying with sweetheart?
Leah is going to need all her skills to get through to young Lisa. Back at the missing persons unit, while he waits for the report on the blood tests, Mark receives news of another sighting of Bill Roach from Armidale detective Greg Lamy.
Hello, Greg. I'm well, mate. Yourself?
Oh, not too bad, not too bad. Look, we've had a couple of developments in the Roach matter.
Yeah, wonderful. What are they?
It's yet another lead in the 13-year-old case.
We had a fella come in the other day. He just returned from an address in Brisbane. It was a weekend. He tells me that he saw Bill.
This time, an old university friend has spotted Bill.
So someone who actually, like, knows him well?
No, oh, knows him very, very well.
Excellent.
He's telling me that there's no doubt in his mind that it was Bill Roach. I guess that coincides a bit with an anonymous Crime Stoppers report we got through the week before, saying that also seen Bill Roach, or who they believe to be Bill, in the Wynnum area at Brisbane.
Excellent.
First, the Crime Stoppers report, and now a second sighting. Two sightings in two Brisbane neighbourhoods.
I certainly intend to go out there and have a bit of a look around.
Do you want a hand from our unit?
Absolutely.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm not discounting the stuff that's going on in Brisbane, especially seeing our witness was someone who had actually an association with Bill. And that's why this lead in Brisbane is going to be
checked out to the best of our ability, because we really have to confirm whether Bill is perhaps living in Brisbane or not.
Have you been staying with sweetheart?
Back in Lismore, as a specialist youth officer, Leah knows how to deal with troubled kids, but it's never easy.
I want to help you, Lisa, but you're going to have to talk to me and give me a little bit more details.
Leah knows she has to tread carefully or she'll lose her.
You said that you wanted to live with your auntie and uncle, is that right? Isn't that a good thing? Are you happy at the house? You're not? Why is that?
They don't let me
go
to my friends.
Okay.
I'm a bit worried as to why Lisa continually runs away, but until I speak with her further, I'm not going to be able to ascertain. I'm new to her and she's not going to want to tell me a hell of a lot. There's something that's upsetting her, but I'm really worried about her being on the streets. Lisa could end up in a lot of bother.
Back in Lismore, 13-year-old Lisa finally tells Leah she ran away to be with her boyfriend, Donald.
If my mum said that it's OK if I stay with Donald's mum, would I be there?
But you need to tell me why you want to stay at Donald's mum's. Why is that place so special?
Donald's mum said if I stay there that I can go to school.
Yeah.
And they're going to move to Newcastle so I can get away from all the stuff down there.
Have you talked about this with your mum or your auntie or your uncle? No? You don't want to be in Lismore anymore because you're fighting with all your old friends, is that right?
All the kids I went to the school, they don't like me anymore.
When you say they don't like you, what do?
They write stuff about me.
Where do they write stuff about you?
Up at Coles and another one, over at the soccer club.
On the walls and graffiti and things?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's why you don't want to live in Lismore anymore.
So, armed with a little more information, Leah and Senior Constable Peter Ellis go to the Department of Community Services, who'll decide where 13-year-old Lisa should live.
She started to open up a little bit, so hopefully now when we go down to docks, we can make some kind of other plans or arrangements for her.
In Melbourne, at the Victorian Institute of Forensic Medicine, DNA specialist April Smith is examining samples taken from Bill Roach's farmhouse.
Well, what appear to be blood stains on the timber flooring may or may not be blood. They're brown staining on the floorboards, and we're just going to test that to see if we can get a human DNA result.
And just a short time later, April gets a result that's not what anyone expects.
I'm sure Mark Samways isn't going to be too happy, but I'll give him a call and let him know the result.
Meanwhile, back in Lismore...
We've left Lisa at the police station and we're going to try and sort out some kind of plan or resolution because hopefully we don't want Lisa to continue running away.
With Lisa's mum in Darwin, and because she says she doesn't want to live in Lismore, her future will be decided by the Department of Community Services.
We've just had a lengthy discussion with Docs and we've come up with a plan that the best thing for Lisa is that she go and reside with her grandmother in Bathurst. We're now going to go and speak with her auntie and uncle, let them know what's going on.
But her uncle Andrew still doesn't know that Lisa has been found.
Good, Andrew.
Hey, Andrew.
Yourself? Oh, yeah, not too bad. Mate, we found Lisa. Found Lisa early this morning up in Egan's place. Just up there with a few mates.
So she's been staying with them, has she?
Oh, mate, I'm not sure if she's been staying there, but it's fairly good info that she was.
Lisa's expressed the desire to get away from Lismore, which is a good step.
Oh,
she states she wants to go to school.
Yeah, I keep saying so, it's not good down here for her.
Yeah, no, that's all right. Yeah. The docs are currently arranging to have her flown to Bathurst. What'll happen? She'll come with us.
Yep.
I'll fly to Sydney with her. All right, and then she'll fly to Bathurst from there.
So for police, their next step is to clear the move with Lisa's nana, Mari, who everyone hopes will get the teenager back on track.
Okay. Yeah. At this point, we just want to get her somewhere where she's happy and she's safe, and then they can revisit the idea at a later stage of her moving to Darwin when her parents have found the house.
Missing persons unit, Mark Samways.
Hi, Mark. It's April here.
Back at Sydney's Missing Persons Unit, Mark Samways gets the call he's been waiting
just
for.
Just calling you about the William Roach case
and the mitochondrial DNA testing. The two pieces of timber flooring, the swab from the concrete and the swab from the carpet underlay.
If the test reveals it's Bill's blood, then it will confirm police suspicion that Bill has been murdered.
Well, unfortunately, we were not able to get a result from any of the items.
So there's nothing there to indicate that it could be our man's blood?
Unfortunately, there's not, no.
Takes us back to square one in relation to the possible homicide inquiry, but in some regards it's good because there's still hope that Bill may be walking around somewhere.
And that hope lies here in Brisbane's Fortitude Valley, where it was reported Bill was last seen. With dozens of surveillance cameras in the area, if Bill was here, he's sure to have been recorded. Back in Sydney,
it's Senior Constable Gail calling from the Missing Persons Unit.
Mandy's hard at work on the bizarre case of the missing Danish engineer. Mandy's calling the Danish consul, who reported Helbi missing over 14 hours ago.
All I know is he was dropped at the airport like a week ago and we've had sort of nothing since.
Ship's engineer, Helbi, checked his bags onto an international flight at Sydney Airport and then disappeared. Immigration doesn't have a record of him leaving the country and his family in Denmark hasn't heard a word.
His wife is very unhappy
because
they had a big party arranged. He's turning 50 years old.
Yeah.
On the 10th of December.
The 10th of December, yeah, I noticed that. It was his birthday for sure.
And then they are very worried about what happens with him.
Yeah, no, definitely, I can understand that.
Okay. With so little to go on, Mandy doesn't know whether Helbi has stayed on for a holiday or if he's met with foul play.
So he's been taken from Newcastle to Sydney Airport on the 30th when his flight was due to fly out. Was last seen in the departure lounge, on the lounge.
So all we've got is this bloke turning up at the airport and then apparently walking out of the airport.
In outback Queensland, in the ongoing case of Paul Laba, it's 5 a.m. and very hot. The temperature already in the 30s. Jim Ryan and Tony McDowell are about to lead a team into the desert to search an area where Paul's tracks were last seen. Last week, Detective Sergeant Jim Ryan from Queensland's Missing Persons Unit flew 1,500 kilometres into the outback to start a new search for 76-year-old opal miner Paul Laba.
Searches were conducted. They were conducted on trail bike, horseback and on foot, but nothing was located.
A year ago, case officer Sergeant Tony McDowell from Winton Police found Paul's ute broken down here on this bush track. 14 kilometres away, Tony found the ute's radiator hanging in a tree.
Where the radiator was found is often this direction.
Tony took Jim back to Paul Laba's bush camp, the first place he searched when Paul went missing.
We didn't find anything there.
It's now just after sunrise, and the SES volunteers are moving into the desert to look for Paul Laba. In a few weeks, it'll be too hot to work out here. So this really is the last throw of the dice, their final chance to find out what happened to the missing opal miner. In the case of the missing Dane, the Missing Persons Unit has asked for assistance from police at the Rocks in inner Sydney. Leading Senior Constable Alison Bly and Constable Vanessa Barwick are visiting the Danish consul to get an update and pick up the photo of Helbi.
We have got a photo right now by email from Denmark of the person we are missing. And we got this from his brother in Denmark. That is his copy of his passport.
Consul General Jürgen Mollegaard says it's very unusual for a Dane to go missing in Australia.
I've been here for 2.5 years and it's the first time it happens. And you try to help the poor family sitting up there, so 17,000 kilometres away and having a birthday party coming up and nobody knows where the husband is.
Back in the office, Mandy is talking to the shipping agency that had planned to employ Helbi.
From Melbourne, didn't arrive.
She learns they sent Helbi from Newcastle to Sydney Airport in a hire car with another Danish national who, unlike Helbi, did leave the country.
So as far as you know, he got home safely?
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So he must have been at the airport with him, because that was the last sort of that we heard, the driver had left them in the departure lounge at the airport. OK.
Well, when
Mandy's next step is to involve police in Newcastle to trace Helgi's last movements. Meanwhile, in the Queensland outback, on the case of missing opal miner Paul Laba,
control centre to SES teams. You on channel, Becky? Over.
The search is delayed, while SES volunteers struggle to set up radio communication.
Becky, you on channel? Over.
Out here, lives depend on radio contact. Without communication, the search and rescue team risks losing one of their own in this unforgiving country.
Control to SES search team. Becky, you on channel? Over.
But things are not going to plan. The radios are still not working.
They should read portable 11 on the screen.
Yeah.
And if someone gets hurt or lost, they could die before help arrives. But the longer they wait, the hotter it gets. So Tony makes the decision. The search is on.
We're going to do about 30 metres apart. What I want you particularly to be mindful of is who's on either side of you. Make sure you can see them at all times so that we're watching our mates. Just be mindful, you've got plenty of water. If someone runs out of water, just give a call. Well, there may be snakes. All right, so if we can just head down over towards this direction now.
Today, 1 year after he disappeared, police might finally uncover the truth about what happened to Paul Laba. Meanwhile, in Newcastle, the local police are going to talk with Helgi's boss, hoping to find out why he disappeared.
We're a shipping agency. We've been hired by a shipping company in Denmark. They needed to change the chief engineer, and this was the replacement chief engineer.
But he never got to work on his ship.
In the first place, he missed his flight in Denmark because he was apparently drunk, intoxicated or whatever. So they arranged for another chief engineer to come out and join the ship. In the meantime, he turned up in Newcastle, so we put him up in hotel room for a couple of nights.
So how did he react to that when you told him that he's no longer required?
Oh, he didn't show too much emotion. He's pretty straight sort of a character. Yep. Didn't really react too much to what I said.
So, in no state to work, the shipping company had to send Helgi back to Denmark along with the engineer he was meant to replace.
Yep, so they organised for the flights back and we arranged for a hire car just to take him down to the airport.
But despite the shipping company's best efforts to get him home, Helgi clearly had other ideas.
They had contact details with the other guy that got in the hire car. I wonder if he'd be able to say, yeah, he was talking to him, he didn't get on the flight. He said he was going to go hang around down the rocks at Circular Quay, or maybe this guy's just left him there, but maybe he knows where he was headed.
So, where is he?
You guys ready?
You hear me over there? Far end? Yeah. All right, just start moving forward slowly.
In outback Queensland, the team of volunteers has begun its search for missing opal miner Paul Laba. The volunteers picked their way through the gullies near where police found Paul's radiator from his broken-down car.
We're looking for anything that doesn't fit into the natural habitat surroundings.
Jim thinks Paul might have disappeared on his way back from his camp to pick up the radiator left hanging in the tree.
Anything that could identify that Paul may have either been through here or may have met with some untimely incident through here.
The temperature is now nudging 48 and only getting hotter. As they focus on every metre of terrain looking for clues, the heat begins to take its toll.
Falling a fair bit behind over on the right-hand side there.
All right.
that joint though looks more, I'm more inclined to think Saru.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Finally, after 4 hours and 10 kilometres of hard slog, the volunteers have covered the entire search area. But they've found nothing.
It's been well worth the effort because we've been able to cover all this area and we'll be out now can take this area off as an area of interest to us for this particular missing person.
Wasn't real good terrain the whole way. Fairly hot. But once again, just thanks very much for your effort. Thank you.
After a day in the desert, the search is called off. But as Jim returns to Brisbane to follow up on the breakthrough in his long-term case of Bill Roach, there's an unexpected development in the disappearance of Paul Laba. In the Queensland outback, the mystery of Paul Laba's disappearance just took another twist.
Yeah, out near Paul Laba's camp.
Just when they thought the search was over, the desert reveals another secret.
Where exactly did you find these, Shane? Yeah, no, that'll be fine. Bring them
in. A road crew has found a case for a pair of glasses right where Paul went missing.
Yeah, that'll be great. Thanks, Shane. I'm going to go out and have a look at the scene, have a look at the glasses case where he found them. It's in an area about half a K from the entrance to Paul Laba's camp. It's in an area that we haven't previously searched, so go see what we... see what he has found and see whether it's worthwhile us doing a further search of that area.
Meanwhile, back at Lismore Police Station...
Hello.
Mari, how you going? Peter Ellis from Lismore
Police. Case officer Peter Ellis is still trying to find a home for 13-year-old Lisa Peters with her nan, Mari, in Bathurst.
Mate, we found her up here in Lismore and we just need to know if you'd take her in down there at Bathurst this afternoon.
If she behaves herself, if she runs away on me, she's gone, OK?
Yeah, no, that's fair enough, mate. We've had a bit of a yarn to her and we've sort of knocked that on the head. We've been down and spoken to docs and we're going to organise some flights for her to turn up at Bathurst there at about 5 to 8 this evening.
Yep. Hello there.
Yeah, Margaret.
Yep.
Yeah, next, awesome. Peter calls Lisa's mum, who's thousands of kilometres away in Darwin...
And the phone number
and worried is sick.
So what's going to happen is we're going to bung her on a flight out of Ballina down to Sydney and then Sydney on to Bathurst where Mari's going to meet her at the airport and then take her in.
Okay, yeah. Is she okay?
Yeah, mate, she's fine. She's had a food, like I said, and we're just going to go and pick up some clothes and, yeah, we'll get her on the flight.
I just tell her I love her and I'm glad she's okay.
Yeah, right. Righto, Margaret, you take it easy.
Now okay. Peter has one last job, to tell Lisa she's off to Bathurst.
She'll be fine. This is the way you approach things. It's the only way she can possibly go and make a good go of it, rather than sort of being on the street and just, yeah, living rough, so to speak.
In the Queensland desert, 1,500 kilometres northwest of Brisbane, Tony is off to check where road crews found a spectacle case that belongs to missing bushy Paul Laba.
The actual finding of the case is probably fairly important for our investigation because it shows that he definitely was there at some time. Whether or not we're going to find anything in that location, I'm not sure.
The spectacle case is the only personal item of Paul's that's been found in the desert after two long searches.
Finding the glasses there probably helps confirm my own beliefs that Paul probably did make it out of the bush when his car broke down. I believe there's enough information that we've been able to gather to show that he did actually make it back to his campsite. Because from what I've found from people that know him, he generally carried his glasses with him wherever he went.
In Lismore, it's time to tell Lisa Peters that she's going to be living with her nan, Mari.
Mate, as you know, we've been down to the doc's office, spoken to docs. Mate, we've organised for you to go down to your grandmother's place down in Bathurst. And then you can get back into school and stuff like that down there, OK? Now, what happens is you're going to go fly down to Sydney, probably about 3 o'clock, with the good constable here, and then you'll wait with her until you get a connecting flight down to Bathurst where Mari and the rest of the family's going to meet you down there, OK?
That would be good.
Sorry, doll.
not
want to leave yet. Lisa, unfortunately, you can't keep running away, and we're really worried about you. You said you hadn't been eating properly. All right, you don't have any of your things, and you're 13, duh. You said you wanted to go to school. You said you didn't want to be in Lismore anymore because it was too hard for you. And we're trying to give you all those things. Staying here, you're not going to get that. And we want to get you back in school where there's people that don't pick on you.
Lee has been in this situation so many times before, remaining sympathetic while explaining a tough decision that's in Lisa's best interests is never easy.
I've just told Lisa that she's going to be going to Bathurst to the grandparents. Now she's changed her mind from this morning, stating that she wanted to leave Lismore and stating that she wants to stay here. However, we can't allow Lisa to live with her friends. She's obviously going to continue to run away from Andrew and Alison.
She may only be 13, but if Lisa doesn't want to stay in Bathurst, she'll only run off again. So Leah still has a lot of work to do. But will Lisa listen? In the case of the missing Danish engineer, Mandy finally gets a clue from the Danish consulate.
We got this message from the bank that he cashed some money on the 1st of December.
Which bank was that?
The ATM transaction suggests Helgi is alive and still in the country.
Northwest?
Town. It's King Street.
King Street, Newtown?
Probably too.
Not Northwest Town.
Mandy tells the Danish consul that it's Newtown and acts quickly to launch a public appeal.
Police are appealing for information to help find a missing 49-year-old Danish tourist described as being of white European appearance.
Armed with the information from the missing persons unit and after some detective work of his own...
Good morning, Mr. Mulligard.
..the worried consul calls back.
During the weekend, we found him in
Newtown. I went there to have a talk with him
and to give him some money so he could survive, and then...
He has a ticket now.
..and leaving Sydney tonight.
Look, the main thing is, obviously, he's fine, and...
..back with his family by tomorrow.
It's a good result, but even though Helgi's turned up, Mandy's heading out to the airport to make sure this time he gets on the plane.
My name's Mandy, this is Gary, and we need to check up on this gentleman.
OK. He has checked in.
Helgi is here.
We might just have a wander around, see if we can see him and catch up and make sure he's okay.
Mandy still needs to sight him before the case is closed. And there he is.
You missed your birthday.
No, I had it here.
You had it here? He's been here without family and money for a few days, and I think you're very relieved to be going home. I'm glad you're okay. You take care.
Not much, thanks, but for the missing persons unit, it's a job well done and another case closed.
He's fine.
Meanwhile, in outback Queensland, 1,500 kilometres away from Brisbane, Sergeant Tony McDowell and a team of police are heading back into the desert to where a road crew found Paul Laba's spectacle case.
The cases were probably found about a kilometre from his camp, actual campsite, and it's an area that there is no track through, but it is the most direct route if someone was walking from his camp to an area called Bridges Creek Bore, where is a fresh water supply that Paul was known to use to get his fresh water.
It makes perfect sense to Tony that Paul was in the area collecting water, and that's why he's making one last-ditch effort to find out what happened to the 76-year-old.
So it wouldn't surprise me at all that Paul would have walked this area, either walking back from when his car broke down or walking back from getting water from Richards Creek. But this is where the glasses case were found at the end of this culvert here. It's got Paul's name engraved in the back here. It's definitely his glasses case.
Paul's a tough bushman who's lived and worked out here for over 20 years. He often went barefoot, living off the land for months at a time. So even though he's been missing for a year, Tony reckons he could still be out here alive.
And that's where his campsite is, just only about another half a K over from where we are here. but this is the most likely direct route to the water supply, straight up through, through this gully here, up this creek line.
At police headquarters in Brisbane, Mark has met up with Greg Lamy, the Armidale detective who's been looking for Bill Roach for 13 years. They're here to meet with Jim Ryan. He's just returned from looking for Paul Laba in outback Queensland to help Mark and Greg with their search for Bill.
Up the office at the powwow and see how we're going to plan today.
These three men have been looking for Bill Roach for over a decade, and they've never had leads as positive as these sightings. In outback Queensland, Tony and the team have now reached the spot where Paul Laba's spectacle case was found.
Just looking to see if we can find any clothing or bags, maybe a firearm or a knife, or any sort of remains, anything that may show us where Paul may have walked to, where he may have disappeared to. All these creek lines here flow down to where the glasses case were found, so we'll just see if there's any other evidence that may be laying around half buried.
But it won't be easy, because this is channel country and rains may have washed away any clues.
All right, well, we've covered that whole area which flows down to this gully here, which pretty much covers everything that we can do for that side of things. Didn't find anything, but we'll, at least we've eliminated this area as a part of our inquiries.
After yet another search, Tony and his team are tired and frustrated, and still no closer to working out what happened.
He hasn't touched his bank accounts. He hasn't touched his social security. He hasn't used his Medicare card, and he certainly hasn't used his passport. So it leads us to believe that he probably is somewhere still out here. He hasn't just gone away. In my report to the coroner, I'll be recommending my belief that Paul has passed away out here somewhere. But he's a fairly tough old bugger. He's lived out here for a long time, so you just really don't know. He could be out there somewhere.
Back at the Queensland Missing Persons Unit, getting a look at any surveillance footage that may locate Bill in Brisbane is their next crucial step.
We've been on to the CCTV people. They need a police officer to sit with them and go through the footage and identify who the person is.
You know, we'll be seeking to get a good shot of the person who we saw so we can sort of follow up from them.
I suppose the most important thing for us is this guy knew him intimately.
Mm.
And so it's not like someone out of the blue that's seen Bill's photo on TV. So this guy actually associated with him at the time he went missing. So for him to be adamant that it was Bill, there's got to be some credence to it.
So they're anxious to meet their eyewitness, Bill's old friend, Bly Grant.
I think if we go down to the valley first, meet with Bly and have a look at the tape.
If Bly has seen his mate Bill, there's every chance he's been captured by one of the dozens of surveillance cameras in the area.
It's probably the first possible evidence of life we've had for, 12, 13 years?
Every year, over 30,000 people go missing. Have you seen 35-year-old Shah Mueller, last seen in Hobart in 1996? Or 45-year-old Gregory Christensen, missing from Port Germain, South Australia, in 2003. And 40-year-old Julie Cutler, who disappeared from Perth in 1988. If you have any information, please call 1-800-333-000.